I'm traveling to a place that shows the terrifying power of climate change. I'm going to visit the north of my country, where hundreds of thousands of families have lost their homes in floods. Climate change driven by fossil fuel use has increased the risk of flooding across the world. I've heard oil pollution in the area is making a bad situation even worse.
The oil in the environment and in contact with the human being is a silent killer. So with this flood right now, it is a disaster.
You can see the flooding waters here. Look at the water, and look at the calm this side. The only thing that's supporting those people is this long water dike to keep them dry and safe.
I've managed to get rare access to the area to try to see what's really going on. This is part of Unity State before the floods and after. In 2019, extreme flooding began. At the flood's peak in 2022, up to 70% of Unity State was underwater. More than 700,000 people have been affected across the country. Tens of thousands moved into Bentiu camp. Today, I'm meeting a village elder called Nyakuma in camp. She's agreed to show us her flooded home.
Nyakuma, male, chaba kamal.
Chaba kamal.
Tamam?
Kamal.
Yesim kef.
Mada, mila ma kana bawe you.
Matara kan kef umbare.
Yadam koko. Dun yeo kora yeo kata wong ngere yeo kora. Yeo kora uri ngan duel nan ga yeo biluanyo.
South Sudan has always had some flooding in the wet season, but it's becoming more extreme every year. It's now the end of the dry season, and the water's still here.
Tamam, pilot? Nyakuma. Nyakuma. Ana ma baarif kalamta kanu de. Kef. Male mugwa. Mal ma chum chum. I'm panicking. I'm stressed. I am yet to get used to canoe because swinging left and right. Oh, we have cows around even.
The Nuer people of this area have always kept cattle, but the floods have changed everything.
Anna, what's in
there?
Okay.
Hey, hello.
Ah, shalukulu. We made it, yes, finally. This is Nyakuma's house. Mosh? Male, Sidubet. Kif, tamam, alhamdulillah.
Without cattle and with crops underwater, food is scarce. Nyakuma and her family have no choice but to forage for food like the edible roots of water lilies.
Nyakuma,
da u ajadal kulu shalu u maki ne gadam ya nagdar ni fitish da ni ajad ne da 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 ikutu ya ni zai da da ni ajad ga ina kullu da ni ajad na zai yakul chunu da ni ajad ne Yana kulu. Au da da ma mu wala bi to wanu ze tin. Lakin do ma ligida mana fitish tanuda di fitish da fi jo barda di tallo win. Di kwore je na nyure gar kol kam. Dinu dan. Dinu dan ya ya ga wa. Dinu dan. Wo da tam garu kal na pada. Da man kida. Lakin do man bi ga asel. Yal suwar zira balab fu lungar ra ra we 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 yom lakin wugur moy reja kalas
ma fi tan
naz bigi chunu ma bi ezol bimchi malwen naz kulu ga da sab benin fadalna elde binakul
Sunday explained the background story of how they used to live here and now before they were really free This space, it was occupied with people, kids playing around. They practice their cultural dances, and the kids even having their freedom. And also the huts, they have a space. But the water pushed them to a small spot like this. And he said they're living like a mosquito, and they cannot even have their freedom because now it's more of population pressure in one space. And it had reduced even the intercommunal conflict among them, yeah.
Sunday, Nyakuma and their daughter Nyariak invite me to join their hard-won meal.
Nyakuma, cham. Shandawa, dawa der akil fijisim.
The flood waters harbor diseases. Nyakuma has recently recovered from malaria.
Galu ni tu derum si yakul leo samak. Ani chugol le gal kafale niya. Si talla leo samak na yakul.
Kala sanu si yip samak de yakul ka.
Yenu nuro duro ibi becham. Aki nuro du. Amar gyo le tur.
Ba wora ifi ne ba komo joy. Mo iko yiti amadi. Ana.
Galu asa.
Kaya na ne ba ye cham. Chako riam da ye bagrar che ta ge la chami cha. Ana. Mati le kuma malu ko. Da ko chuyi choyin di de wona na penyi ma. Chual nan kam ko yuwe. Chual. Ba ko le jote ne baro.
It's no wonder so many have moved into Bentiu camp. It's run by the United Nations and houses 140,000 people displaced by war and now by climate change. But life here is hard too and requires cash. And it's a constant battle to earn it. I meet Nyaida, who has recently spent all her savings to set up a tea shop.
Ufai, macam sih, ufai sekali. Leh aku berapa muda, muda ni, belum kau.
Okay, pasti anda kau kembali.
Uwa, lebih baik dah. Nanti dia kasih.
Oh,
kau tu kuat dengan telat. Bawar badan, leh aku jiran.
Oh, baik. Maka tamil bukhur.
Oh, kau.
It's like a essence. It makes The place smells better because, you know, water is everywhere and the mud had a smell, so it's really healthy. You will not smell every time the sticky or stinky smell of the mud. Smells good. Water, it's really hard to get here, despite people living in the flooding waters. Like for Nyaida, now she's feeling
a small barrel at $1. It's almost 3,000 South Sudanese pounds. It's crazy. Nyaida has to support her family of seven children alone. But she has another way to earn cash. Charcoal. It's an essential for camp life, and it's been harder to get because of the floods.
It's okay. Mind him here, Mark.
She earns a little profit from selling this charcoal to her neighbors. Okay. With money running low, Nyaida needs to get more charcoal to sell. She'll have to travel across the flood plains to gather wood and make charcoal. It's an 8-hour walk to the forest. There is fighting in the region, and she is leaving her kids for a week. It's a dangerous journey. The floods have hit our country when we are very vulnerable. South Sudan was founded only 13 years ago. After decades of civil war, we hoped for peace, but fighting continues in many areas. The nation's poor, and the government depends almost entirely on oil for income. The country's oil fields, including in Unity State, can produce crude oil worth approximately 9 million pounds sterling a day. The BBC has spoken to David Boju Leju, formerly a senior engineer for GPOC, an oil consortium in Unity State.
I got a job with the Greater Pioneer Operating Company, GPOC, as construction supervisor in the five fields of Unity State. Nothing can go without us knowing in the oil field.
GPOC runs the Unity State oil field. It's a joint venture between Malaysian, Indian, and Chinese oil companies, with South Sudan's government owning 5%. David alleges that GPOC mismanages facilities, polluting the environment. He shared videos he recorded when he worked there.
I was employed into an environment where there's an existing pollution. I had witnessed wells spilling out. Oil spill is a recurring situation.
He says GPOC's infrastructure is old and unsafe.
Oil spills from the wells itself, wellheads. Oil spills from wells connecting other pipe connecting other wells. Oil spills from the main export pipeline that had happened in a big quantity in 2019 and 2020.
Lot of oil all over still. This oil exists for over 4 months still. That is an area near drinking sources for the community around. been cultivating that site and all over that side of the road.
David left Jipok in 2020 after 8 years. He says the pollution he saw was never cleared up and is more dangerous now than ever.
So with this flood right now, it is a disaster. The whole of that contaminated soil with the hydrocarbon is going to be flooded all over United States. I feel the effect of the oil in the environment and in contact with the human being is a silent killer.
To find out more about the impact of the oil pollution on communities, I'm on my way to Roriak, a settlement 20 kilometers north of Bentiu and right in the heart of the oil fields. Chief Chilhokpot leads a community of herders. They were displaced by fighting, and so the government assigned them this area to live and graze their cattle. They tell me they fear pollution from the nearby wells is making their cattle sick. Wow. Over 117,000 cows have died in Unity State in the last 2 years, according to the state's Minister of Agriculture, who blames it on flooding and oil pollution. He called on central government to investigate. What of the cattle that roam around the oil field drinking water in those sources? Where do we see the end result of hydrocarbon?
This is a contaminated water with the oil, and you see the color. This water is covering kilometers of areas.
David thinks that livestock and people in the Roriak area are likely to be affected by the oil spills he saw, which may have seeped into the groundwater.
The water table is contaminated. If a sample of water is to be measured in several boreholes in United States, definitely majority of the borehole have unclean water. It's because the environment is polluted. Some of the oil chemical seeped down. It is carried by the water, the flood, and others seep down into the ground.
This is the untold, unexposed environmental damage.
David says there is another factor polluting the area. Wastewater from oil production that wasn't properly treated.
Environmental pollutions come from oil spill in the environment, and then they produce water in the field production facilities. Oil is separated from water. Oil goes to the storage tank. The water separated has to be pumped back to the environment. These are the pond. Water is received here. This water come and there are different sections of the ponds. Every day in our morning meeting in Jipok, there are reports of high content of oil in the produced water, which is not in conformity to international standard. And this water is injected back to the environment. The question is, where does water flow? Up to the people, up to the river, up to the water source where people drink, up to ponds where people catch fish, up to ponds where people swim. Who knows the amount of hydrocarbon in those water?
While Nyaida is away in the forest, her kids, Nyasheng and Mamuch, have to take on new responsibilities.
مونا علمك تقشر سمك بس بيتقد شوفي سوف اقول طوالي بس عشان زمنا اي اقعد كده بهنا خلاص هيا لو وروني بعد سمك ده ينجد مني جاي اخده في نار
قول
ما ينجد بقول لهم خلي وريني صعب في شنو صعب في بيت هنا شنو بعمل
هذا كثير البرميل لما في مصاري
مشتاقين لماما ولا لا؟
قال نحن دايرين نلوم مع امي
Nyaida has arrived in the forest, which is near Roriak. Friends and relatives have joined them to help.
Itu kam kira?
Wow. Nyaida tells me that before the floods, there wasn't the need for these long trips away from home.
Mamun kana sashin da bagar gana ma ya do na zu kurin bai din. Ukin mu eja. Ajab na zuno nas katir gafa kashe bu amul kef 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 da. Da ma shan mahalal fi yidin na kullum fa madu.
Asta shayl hamshino. Ita gati fakir fi shinasi.
فكر يال بتاعو يال قاعدين في البيت عندي يال
ثاني كون بانكو
كين الثلاث يوم ده بيعمل لنا مشكله في البيت ثاني يال قاعدين ساعات البيت فكر في البيت
مش تخليت حاجه ما يال هناك
حاجه جاي لكن كلام غروي صعب الدنيا ده داير غروي سوال
They light a fire in this structure to turn the wood to charcoal. The process takes days, and they can't go home until it's done. Meanwhile, they'll camp here, but it's near Roriak's oil fields, and they can't find clean water. I had to see the chief of Roriak again. He tells me the families moved here by the government can't get clean water either.
Is it moe fi bejai?
Mala okore tam.
Moe da nadif?
Ma nadif. Tere din wataku we an matako tine. Take jath. Take kemakon.
I meet more families living near the oil facilities.
Yalla go athina jambi mahal ta chemical la mahasa mahal.
The mothers say they want to stay here because there is a school nearby.
Wow.
Where are you going?
هل أفكار كثير قبل في راسك إذا خايف كلام مويه ده؟
A German NGO, Sign of Hope, conducted two peer-reviewed studies of communities living near oil fields in Unity State. They found high sulfate content in the water and heavy metals in human hair samples. These are indicators of oil pollution and could increase the risk of birth defects. The NGO told the BBC that government officials said their work went against government interests. Under pressure, they withdrew their staff because of security concerns. Off camera, someone shows me a picture of a baby with birth defects who died here.
Kalam de sab ya sultan.
Ah.
Kalam de sab. Deri naarif kalam yaal al buldum beras fate marrati din mafi.
Me dan titine te chara tuh dora. Me shiwa utuk betulun. Shiwa utuk piu. Kam pi chara beliom kail ke. Kamara dinan tere je betulun. Kan gat bagadis tinin. Bagaladies, she got a dane, I knew. Made dane, she got 12 and Tatana. Michaka Guarting. Cool, I'm wake up a labuka, real one. Chain was who contact with Jock. Young Mamman got up King Jack, she a limb. Catatona, Miller and Necker, Chaku Hugo.
What the chief tells me about the birth defects is really worrying, and I need to find out more. So I go to visit the hospital in Bentiu. The doctor takes me to meet a mother and her newborn baby. The hospital doesn't have the facilities to do genetic tests, and it's rarely possible to know for certain the cause of any genetic abnormality in a child. But the doctor thinks pollution might be a factor.
This woman come due to problem of oil. Okay, they used to rupture, this pipeline used to rupture, and those people have no access to clean water. They just drink from the river, where the river water and oil are mixed. That might be the problem.
Outside the ward, the doctor tells me he has seen many similar cases.
Like in Bentiu and Rue, people are suffering. People born with no limb. People born with small head. Yes, microcephaly. Sometimes hydrocephalus. Yes. There are many. Sometimes child will be born like this, will take only one day, will die. Another one will take 1 month, another one will take 1 year. Our environment is polluted by oil, okay? The water must mix with the oil. If this water are not treated well, they will cause also abnormality, genetical abnormality, okay?
He tells me he's been trying to keep track of cases of babies born with birth defects. He wants the government to keep a proper register of babies with genetic problems and investigate the causes.
What pains me much is the local that stay around. The effect that the community complain about their birth defects.
Hundreds of thousands of barrels got spilled in this area.
David says he challenged his managers.
In a meeting, I was able to speak, why don't we clean the environment? Why do we take soil from a location which is polluted, and then we take to another locations to hide it?
But he says they didn't try to clean up the oil-polluted soil, merely told him to contain and hide the problem.
A lot has to be done.
Contaminated soil with the pure oil. They are black, as you see, is totally black. Because it is connected at the roadside, the company say we have to take away because it's giving a very bad image to the company. So this soil, huge mountain of soil here, were transported and put here, hidden here in this location. There is no treatment plan for soil. There's nothing called treating soil in United States.
Many people do not know what is happening here.
David says when the extreme rainfall started in 2019, they tried and failed to keep the pollution from getting into the flood water.
Because it was so huge, it's taking months and months. We had to produce a dike, just some heap of soil, but it was not enough to withstand the volume of water. And now the question, here is a flooding. Where will this soil be swept? Where will it end? The whole area is watery, and this soil mix with the water. The hydrocarbon seep to the water, and this water is spreaded all over Unity.
In Bentiu, Nyaide is still not home. She's trapped in the forest by fighting in the area. Afland village elder Nyakuma and her family have had to leave their village to stay in her brother's hut near the camp.
Hey, listen, Kev. Tamam. Shagal shunu lela.
Olad shagal.
Hosh.
Dere tirabu shagal hosh.
Ah.
Bayan nabzir mudo.
Okay.
They've come because Nyakuma is sick. They suspect her malaria is back.
Nyakuma, sabah al khair.
Kef.
Mali.
Mali.
Maluka.
Maludi. Tamam.
Tamam.
Jisim kef. Jisim kef.
Jisim yang ni anga joy. Kau anda wuru latar yang dah nene.
Desa no. Kerja video moya.
Didi.
Sehingga kita kau tukun ayam.
Wati yang. Ni anu luana.
Asi jisim sukun wala bari?
Bari.
Ma fi milaya, tagati? It's terrible outside. It's quite terrible. I ran to my container. My mind is still busy about people outside there. How are they managing, especially Nyakuma? She's been sick and the rain is just really, really strong. At least the container is keeping me safe. But thousands of displaced persons outside there, they're just stuck under their poor shelter. And the water level also, it's rising. Coming all the way this side, interacting with the people, especially women and children, it's a different world. It's a catastrophic. This is enough. It's a torture. Sometimes you ignore your emotions just to take the message outside, to show the reality. Because it's enough emotion torture, what I'm seeing around here, yeah.
David and his family have been forced into exile in Sweden. In 2020, David shared his evidence of pollution with South Sudanese lawyers who wanted to take legal action over oil pollution in Unity State.
I was contacted by someone who was preparing to sue the government because of these environmental pollutions. Because of the pain that I have for a long period of time and what I see happening in the oil field affecting the people and the environment, I had to come in to provide the evidence to the court. I was not against the government, so I was sure I would be protected as a witness. But one day, a flight was sent when I was in the oil field in Unity State. Without my notice, a security personnel who is also working in the oil field told me, pick your bag, you are to go to Juba. The government needs me to answer questions about the oil case. The security personnel who were near me hit my head with the pistol and forced me to sign this document without saying anything.
The lawyers have not pursued the case for pollution against the government.
Killings is not something new in South Sudan. It is daily. Do you think it would be very difficult for me to be disappeared? My life can easily be disappeared. The government feel anyone talk about the oil is touching the heart of the government. I had to seek for asylum, and I was given an asylum to Sweden. My spirit all is tied back home, and I miss it so much. In South Sudan, we really cultivate on our natural soil. And we feel, when we do this, we feel connected back home. Planting is in my blood.
Nyakuma has recovered from her bout of malaria.
Pal ne yil yille no ngarar yer pala ol akan nyen kon ti lar ko ti lal ko ay yeden ba gorba 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 ba lel kon.
She's determined to go home as soon as she's strong enough.
Ta pur bo pur bel wo pin wo ko wo piu to to wo pin rona bi pi to pi na wa rar ba yang na rar ba yang lo gur bo mo to o kel yang mo dab go bi na yang wo je ke wo o ti yang.
Nyaida and the others managed to hitch a ride out of the forest and bring their charcoal home safely.
Welcome.
Khamsa shawal bi jib lek kam.
After the 6 days Nyaide spent away, £5 sterling for the charcoal is barely enough to cover her rent. But she's finally reunited with her kids. I'm so relieved that the families I've met are in a better way. but I'm very concerned by the risks they face from the environment, which are only getting worse.
I'm back to Juba. The next plan is to meet the first deputy speaker for the Council of States, Honorable Mary Ayen. She will tell me more about the facts that are happening in the northern part of the country.
Mary Ayen is a senior politician from the ruling party, from an oil-producing area. She's been raising concerns about children with birth defects with central government and thinks there could be many more cases.
I've seen myself, my own relatives, giving birth to children born with deformities. I know that also in most of the villages, it's only areas that are around hospital where those cases are reported, but most cases are not reported.
You have any evidence, photos you can share with us?
We have reports from hospital. I have many photos. So yes, there are evidences. This is one child, this is the other one. They are twins. So they were born in Parian Hospital. Actually, that was last April. There are so many cases, but this year, all of them died except this one. This child is still alive. It was born in Pamir, in Jamjang, Rue.
Mary says after mounting pressure, the government launched an environmental audit last year.
So samples from the human blood, from their hair, from soil, from water were taken and sent to laboratories. And when it was launched, the government declared that the results will come out in 90 days. And I think that was last September.
In August 2024, Petronas, part of the GPOC oil consortium in Unity State, announced it was pulling out of South Sudan. The government is blocking it from selling its assets, saying they are legally obliged to pay for an environmental cleanup first. Meanwhile, the government still has not released any environmental audits of the area.
The government had said they will produce an audit report in 1 year. Where has the 1 year ended? Why are they delaying in publishing the audit report? Why? And time will come, all these wells will dry off. Chinese will leave, Indian will leave, Petronas has left. What have they left with South Sudanese now? A cry. Money come, money go. But life is more precious. The environment will never come and go again. The environment is there permanent.
We have ice cream here in Sweden. Yeah, ice cream is part of life, I think, so here. Yeah.
David and his family say they are happy in Sweden, but they are homesick.
My life is connected back home to our environment, our people, our culture, our moral values. That is the basic part of my life. And I think I miss it greatly, and I hope to get connected back home.
I feel like the situation in Unity State is a nightmare I can't forget, an environmental crisis of climate change and pollution. The people there don't have real information. The government hasn't yet released an environmental audit. There is no register of birth defects. They are left with so many questions, but no answers, and nowhere else to go.